Todd.
Todd.
Rundgren.
Rundgren.
Todd.
Todd.
Rundgren.
Rundgren.
Todd Rundgren.
Todd Rundgren. Bye. That's Todd.
At this point in time, I'm looking forward to exploring areas that are pretty much virgin territory.
What does TRI mean? The TR is obvious, I hope. The I stands for interactive.
The first rocker ever to program, record, and actually release an interactive CD was Todd Rundgren.
Todd Rundgren's been pushing the limits of pop music since the early 70s as a recording artist, producer, video innovator, and inventor.
For your mental pollution. Don't let no one tell you that God ain't got a sense of humor. Somebody said he's pissed off, but that was just a rumor. I know he's laughing when the preacher starts to scream about how tripping is evil and sex is unclean.
And so I had to sort of make a reassessment, you know, how do I get back in the groove here, you know, what am I going to do about all this computer knowledge I've been accumulating and stuff like that. So I hit on the concept of interactive music and started recording the music for this project. And the main difference between a regular CD, which is not interactive, and an interactive CD like this is, the non-interactive CD is going to be the same every time you put it in to the machine. But this CD is going to be potentially different every time you play it, according to what you tell it to do. In other words, it listens to you, is interested in what you have to say.
I call it slavery, when you call someone your property. Don't waste your vanity, I will never be your property. Something wonderful,
It may just look like a stage being set up before the band arrives, but look again. This is no ordinary concert.
It was unique in the sense we've never had a situation like this, to my knowledge, where a stage has been set up in the middle of the floor with no security around it.
Who else could be playing in a concert like this but one of rock's most creative performers, Todd Rundgren?
I'm trying to utilizing a basic philosophy of interactivity, blur the line between the performer and the audience, the sort of traditional dividing line that exists at the stage's edge.
Todd lays down some ground rules. When he flashes a red light, that means the stage is his space. When it's yellow, the space is for the dancers. And the green light...
You own the space!
One of the songs that Todd really got the audience involved in was Bang the Drum All Day.
It was quite an experience because usually you go to a show and you're just dancing around, but this time you get to actually, you know, kind of like, you know, put your input into the whole concert. It's pretty cool.
It makes you feel a part of it. You know, he makes you feel at home. It makes you feel like you're part of creating what he's doing.
And what about this band? He got to play solo.
Kind of a once-in-a-lifetime thing, and just got up there and went. You know, I didn't have any time to think about being self-conscious.
Don't quit your day job. Don't quit your day job. Don't quit your day job.
But Todd Rundgren, what was it like working with Ringo?
Ringo is, of course, a... I don't know, I can't find enough superlatives. You know, as a member of the Beatles, of course, you know, everyone who plays with him realizes that they owe him and the Beatles a certain debt, because a lot of us would not even be in the music business. We all realize that that formula that the Beatles came up with has been our livelihood. And so, you know, just playing with him is a privilege. You know, if Ringo asks you to play with him, you don't even think twice. You say, of course I will.
Tell us about CD Plus.
Yeah, this is big. This is hot, and this is brand new from this guy, The Individualist.
That'll be my next CD, but it's not just a regular CD. It's a CD Plus, which is a new format that Philips and Sony came up with that allows you to put computer data in the extra space on the disc. And you can put it into a regular CD player, and you don't have to do anything special. It's just like a regular CD, but if you put it into a computer with a CD-ROM drive, then the computer will recognize the extra data, and you can have graphical presentations. So there'll be a visual accompaniment to every song. There'll be a little video editing toy that you can edit one of our live shows with, and some interactive lyrics, things like that.
The mystery of your soul, it's like a black hole. The gravity is too thick. You've got to learn to lighten up a bit. It's such a frightening thing to realize. Every time you close your eyes, you've been cut down to size. Cause you're stuck with yourself. Ain't nobody else in there to compare yourself to. It's just you. And then you ask yourself, what's it all about? So you try to figure it out, and that's when you'll be tempted to believe foolish things and deceive yourself by letting someone else do your thinking for you, when they haven't got a clue. But you can't relive the hype, don't you see? Cause I got a special answer meant just for me, somewhere in my immediate vicinity.
And if there's time enough to get it,
yes, I am.
The individualist.
I am.
The individualist. I'm the individualist.
When I first got into music, albums were what was happening.
Yeah.
You know, let's all get together and make an album and be like the Beatles. And the thing I didn't realize then, having grown up with albums, is that before that, before there were records, music was a much more plastic medium, much more organic and subject to change. And I'm trying to get music back to that in a way by taking advantage of these online developments. And I hope one day to be able to communicate directly with the audience without having to go through all these extra steps that add time and expense to the music making process. So someday, like, I'll wake up in the morning and I'll have an idea for a song, and I'll work on it all day, and I'll record it, and then I'll upload it. And anyone who's connected to that space can hear the music the same day that I make it.
You have successfully accomplished your task, Dr. Meacham. You've assembled an interocitor, a feat of which few men are capable.
Money from record company, and now I figured I've got enough hardcore fans, I can make them do what the record company used to do, which is underwrite the music before I make it. I will let you in on the creative process, show you works in progress. Every time I finish a song, you get to download it, and every 3 months you get an audio magazine like this one here in the mail, so you can play it on your CD player, and essentially you're part of the process in a way.
Is it doing well?
It's doing great so far, yeah. It just started about 3 months ago.
One.
Talk about Patronet. I mean, what are you trying to achieve there? I mean, is this your version of how music should be distributed online?
Well, I think a lot of things have happened since I originally came up with the idea of Patronet, which was initially supposed to be an alternative way for artists, particularly legacy artists like myself, to get underwriting to make new music. In other words, if you've been in the music business for a long time, it gets progressively harder to get a record deal and to develop audience and things like that, but you still have a committed following, and the internet made it possible to tie that following together. So I guess today, the album that was the result of that process comes out. It's called One Long Year.
Our next guest is a great musician who looks terrific in wings, and he's always been ahead of his time. His new CD is called One Long Year, and on Wednesday he'll be performing at Irving Plaza here in New York City. Ladies and gentlemen, Todd Rundgren.
You're my steed, I ride till dawn. And the main vein bleeds till my strength is gone. I'm in the saddle, I'm in the race. I try not to rattle, but you set the pace. When I start to struggle to share your space, you stop and then you stick it in my face. Stick it in my face, just stick it in your face. Race and mind beat my heart to death. I ain't a yokel, but Lord, I swear, this ain't the local, it's express somewhere. When the flat on my cycle ain't got no spare, you stop and then you put your finger there. Put your finger there, you put it. You're fast, I like it. Insane to go on like this. Got my name for God to piss. Am I plain and vain or a slave to bliss? Space was bending, bringing you near. Thought I was transcending, but now I fear. It looks like the ending of my fine career. But you stop and then kiss me over here. Kiss me over here, kiss me then you kiss me over here. Kiss me over here, no.
I like it.
because all of the things that people believe can't all be true. It was the first all-new studio album in about 10 years. And I had been recording in between, but I hadn't been doing essentially the kind of concept albums that most of my records represented. The way I do my best work is to isolate myself for a necessary amount of time until the noise of everyday life abates and I can start to hear what I really think.
Some brains, I was the first in line, 'cause we were like dragging our knuckles along the ground. Ever since I've been convinced that every sacred bond is mine, and you were still dragging your knuckles along the ground. 'Cause I think I'm there too. I think I'm
have a pretty good idea of what I'm going to write about and have turned the subject over in my head, cooked it thoroughly on all sides, and then I go into the studio with the expectation that I am just going to birth this. As truth is devalued as a commodity, you know, you need people whose only interest is truth, whose only commodity is truth. And when, you know, materialism seems to be the earmark of our culture, as opposed to what we used to see ourselves as the big helping hand up in the world, you know, to bring us you're weak, you're downtrodden, and all that other stuff.
Right.
Now it's bring us your investment dollars.
It's been a long, long time since you faced the truth. Yeah, I haven't heard the voice of God since you wasted you. The faith of your father, holy faith, in the dollar almighty and the tithing plate. And you'd like to rub their face in it, your God, your God. And you'd like to rub their face in it, your God, your God, your God is mammon.
The greatest possibility, for instance, about what happens to you after death is that you die. You know, essentially you're dead and nothing happens. That's the most plausible thing that could happen. But that's, you know, that is the most horrifying. Oblivion seems to be the most horrifying thing to contemplate for most people. It's hard enough to think about, let alone dwell on, you know, to try and unravel some of the mystery that's in it. I first of all believe that if you hold in your mind some concept of a God or a motive force of some kind, a causality, that your obligation is not to have somebody else explain it to you, but to go out and figure out what it is on your own terms. And the point is, it's all up to you, you know? None of it is up to God, you know, God the Creator or whatever. He just made it all. It's all there. It runs perfectly. Now you figure it out.
Everyone claims to have heard your voice. And every time they do, I know I should rejoice. Because one day I'm sure you'll break your silence and speak just to me. But I feel like time's running out, and my heart is filling with doubt. God said, 8 or 12, I found you, I dwell on something.
Almost always a projection of what we are. We imagine we created God in our own image.
Right.
You know, if we live in a vengeful society, we believe that God has vengeance on his mind. You know, if we live in a kindly society, we believe that God is kind. It's simply a reflection of us. For me, I look at God this way. If he's there, he's there. You know, he's not there, he's not there. I have a feeling there's something there, but, you know, it's going to be up to me to try and comprehend it. It's not going to come to me and say, I am the girl, la, 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 you know, and only in terms that I can understand, you know. I will have to try and become that thing to the degree that it's manifest in humanity.
There's no anger in me. You must meet someone else. 'Cause it's left me. You see, you're looking at yourself, and I won't give you a prize instead of someone else. 'Cause I don't play favorites, so get over
back, my cheeky little chipmunks. My next band is a legendary rock band from the 1980s. Their new lineup includes Todd Rundgren on lead vocals, performing a new song tonight, not tonight, off the CD It's Alive, out on May 9th. Please welcome the New Cars, everybody.
Sight, but not tonight.
New cars, won't be much more of that. You know, if you do see it, it'll be because we played your corporate event. But no, we're not going to start over again, you know, trying to build a, you know, build a new audience for that. We tried it. We had our moment. The accident that Elliot suffered kind of took the air out of the balloon and just couldn't get it back in.
But tonight, I could make some calls, move things around, and it cancels out. But you're on an all-wrong road, I must go down.
Let's get the crass self-promotion out of the way right away. This is my latest record. If you like in-your-face guitars and a guy screaming like he has his nuts caught in a Belgian waffle iron, then you may enjoy it. That album came about because I had been spending lots of decades, perhaps, getting away from the guitar a bit. I was often just the front man, just the singer. Sometimes I would play a guitar solo or two, or sometimes I would go out on the road solo and play acoustic guitar and piano. But I felt like I was neglecting my first love, in a way, which was the electric guitar, and got back to that on the album called Arena.
Close your eyes and plug your ears and turn away.
the guitar is, you know, guitar refuses to die. It seems almost as though the guitar is some sort of ultimate invention, because there's been so many variations on the guitar, people trying to reinvent it. The Chapman stick, for instance, and there are a few people who play that, and it's a terrific instrument. But is it ever going to replace a guitar? No, I don't think so. Once it got electrified, went into this whole other range of sound that can only be produced by that combination of technology. So it's pretty much a high watermark. I don't know what's going to replace it.
Todd Rundgren, ladies and gentlemen. How about that? How you doing? Nice to see you. Welcome to the show. Hi, Todd. How are you? Good to have you with us again. Thank you very much. Happy holidays to you folks. Here we are, Todd Rundgren, reminding us to strike while the iron is hot.
Johnson, which is basically my third hand versions of Robert Johnson songs as influenced by 60s white blues guitarists.
Where did that album come from? That wasn't like something that you were required to do by a record company, was it?
I wasn't so much required as that I acquiesced as a part of a deal to release my prior record, which was called Arena. And then when we found a distributor, they coincidentally had acquired the publishing catalog for Robert Johnson. They didn't own any actual recordings of Robert Johnson. They just owned the publishing rights. So they wanted someone to do an album of cover songs. Thus, we have an album of Robert Johnson songs, many of which are familiar to the public at large.
Playing in the grass, monkey stuck his finger in that old good cold gas. Oh, red hot, yeah, she got them for sale, yeah. Yeah, she got them for sale, oh yeah. Yeah, she got them for sale, oh yeah. Yeah, she got them for sale.
Walk
personality. Talk
with personality.
Talk with personality.
Talk
with personality.
Well, it's gonna be a pretty bad week.
past year in 2011, I was asked if I wanted to put on a fan camp up in the Catskills, a place called the Full Moon Resort. I think it's lunchtime. From the very beginning, you know, I had orchestral designs, you know, things that I wanted to do with an orchestra. Well, even on the very first Naz album, you know, I was into an orchestra to the point that I ventured into arranging for a lot of players. On my first solo album, I did a song with a large arrangement with other stuff on it. I was a little daunted, you know, it's a big responsibility. But by the time we got to the show was so much fun and the audience was so great, you know, that it just kind of went, the show itself was easy, in a way. And
I expect it'll be the same way this time. I have performed with an orchestra before, but I was doing like Beatles stuff, not my own stuff. So it's really thrilling to hear your own stuff orchestrated and played with so many different colors and stuff in it. At about 8 o'clock or 8:30, get in the car, drive to Hilversum, and we rehearse in the big studio there about 4 or 5 hours a day for the last 4 days.
Play all night.
We've already played all night.
Thank you so much.
Usually, when I've completed a record, I listen to it over and over and over and over and over again to try and study what I've done.
Well, I do spend long hours listening to the most recent work that I've done so that I kind of like absorb it and get over it and don't feel tempted to repeat it.
I take, I lend, I make, I spend, I think, I act, extend, retract, I freak. I cope, I doubt, I hope.
Kaleidoscope.
I sleep, I wake, I'm real, I'm fake. I walk, I ride, I seek, I hide. I'm fast, I'm slow, I'm high, I'm low.
Well, my whole process is pretty much based around a laptop now. And the reason why is because I'm not tied down to a keyboard or a guitar or anything that's larger than a laptop. So I can often at least begin the composition process. It's certainly handy to have a keyboard. Now, you usually depend on that at some point in the process. But it's just as easy, well, it's not just as easy, but it's more convenient, let's say, at some points for me to open up my software, I guess, whatever it is that I'm using, and to start sketching the melody in with the, you know, with the trackpad on the computer, just so I've got it down, you know.
And I'm feeling kind of shoddy, I see someone, but I'm afraid they can't say right.
Days, of course, you had to, you know, and I'm an old guy, in the old days you had to, you know, get a bunch of players together and play it so that you could hear what it sounded like.
Laugh at this, soon you will find out where that line is.
I tried to play the nice guy, you had to be a wise guy, I should just let it pass by.
People drive the technology, or does technology drive people? While in one sense you could say I'm making a commentary about how things have changed and evolved, but yeah. I still try and, you know, stick to my original criteria. I want to write songs that mean something to people regardless of the tools that I'm using.
I don't have a plan to sell myself. Every day's the same old song. Thank you.
whatever life brings, eventually things will just work out.
I look at myself as something of a musical big game hunter, going out and trying to find rare or unusual or things that people have neglected to appreciate and then that I do appreciate and try and incorporate in what I do. And sometimes it's just a matter of the era that you're in.
The kind of records I make are a result of the kind of music that I'm not hearing. You know, if I don't hear something, then I want to hear it, then I make a record of it. And I really get annoyed with myself if I do things according to a formula.
I suppose probably my greatest advantage as a musician is that I was exposed to good music. I think that's probably, you know, from a musician standpoint, your biggest limitation is that you don't hear enough things, you know, to really be able to expand and learn and continue to add to your so-called oeuvre.
People do assume that this was, you know, all a result of some calculation, you know, that each progressive record was an attempt to be accepted or become, quote, a commercial artist. And they're all a result of just some bizarre thing that's in my head. You could say, like, if you were to compare me to a movie director, it would be like David Lynch, you know, in which you look at the movie and you say, what the hell is that supposed to mean? You know, but it means something to him, you know that, you know, because he went through a lot of trouble to do that. So as time has gone on, you know, the audience that stuck with me realized that this is actually what it's about. It's not suddenly liking a record and then expecting the next one to come out and follow up on that success. No, it's just as likely to stick a pin prick in that success by doing something completely different. I always thought success was to buy you freedom, was not to buy you more limitations, you know, right, in terms of what you'd be able to do. So I've always essentially squandered my success on trying to move in some new direction and drag the audience with me.
Well, the end result is I'm still here now. I still have a career because it's not just me moving through these different musical domains. I'm taking my audience with me.
Well, Todd, you have had an enormous impact on all of us, a positive impact, and thank you for your contributions to the world, to music.
Ladies and gentlemen, Todd Rundgren.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.